meeting will call our May 10, 2022, Windermere Town. It's 6:01. Please join me for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And let the record reflect the scene that we do have for the councilperson Williams is absent this evening. Open forum this evening, Ms. Brandy Haynes, 835 Woodendale, and Ms. Amanda, 19 Main Street.
Yeah, I can defer.
You want to defer to HMGP? Range or?
Setback, I have one comment about WastePro, I want to do that one now. I have WastePro setback and, hang on, break moment. Oh, and I just want an update on messy timeline, so those ones are simple, but the one I want to defer.
Why don't you hit us with WastePro now, and then we'll do the others as we go.
Gotcha. In terms of WastePro, I just want to say that I know we're just going to normal annual, looking at the contract with them. And I know there's been a lot of problems in town that's been recently posted in April, pretty much since the beginning of April. They've missed my yard waste 40 to 50% of the time since December. So this isn't like just a new issue for us. They're missing a lot on my street and whatever. I know that when we report it directly to WastePro, so I'm curious in the annual update if the town gets information about how many complaint calls WastePro is getting from residents, because I feel like there might be a disconnect if the town isn't aware of how many people were having problems. That's an issue. I actually found out at the beginning of April before the town, because I was calling and complaining to WastePro and I talked to a district manager, that the reason for it, I was told, was that there was a problem with the landfill, that the landfills were full and they didn't have anywhere to take the trash, and that it wasn't just the yard waste, that it was additional waste as well, which could turn into quite a snowball of a problem. I know that there was another statement made to the town as to the reason why, I forget what it is now, but I've talked to the district manager twice for the whole Central Florida area, and that's what I was told. I used to live in New Jersey and work in New York City, so I know they ship their trash off to somewhere else, so I will be honest and say I told the WastePro guy, we contract to do it with you as a resident, I don't have a choice. We have to go with WastePro because that's who the town chooses. But if they're going to have a continual problem, we might need to look into contracts with other waste services, or they need to truck it further, because we can't just have trash start piling up and not get stuff picked up. So I've encouraged all my neighbors that are having problems to call and complain too, and unfortunately to the town as well, because if the town doesn't know it's happening, how can it be resolved if WastePro just says, well, we'll come another day, we'll come another day.
We're going to get an update tonight. Next up is Colonel Calvin B. Wimbish. He's retired and he is a congressional candidate for District 10.
A brief overview. I moved here in 2004. I am a Windermerean. I lived here for 11 of the last 16 years and moved over to Bay Hill for a short period of time when I got deployed to Iraq and Afghanistan. Came back, moved back to Windermere over in Little Lake Sawyer, and recently moved back to Bay Hill next to the golf course. But I'm still home when I go to the church where I'm a member as a deacon as well as a member of the choir in Windermere. So this is my home, and I'm happy to be part of this community. I brought my wife, Susie, who's been with me 45 years, and told me I needed to rise above my circumstances as things began to change in our nation. Just to give you guys a little bit of background, I was born in Maryland, Baltimore, Maryland, in inner city. And back in the day, before the Civil Rights Act, there were some places that I couldn't go and things I wanted to do, but my parents always told me, never give up, never give in, rise above your circumstances. I've kept that model in my head all my life. And I was able to work my way through college. I got my degree, got commissioned second lieutenant, went to the 82nd Airborne initially, on to the Special Forces on the Green Beret. So Mike Walsh is not the only one that's in Congress, says hopefully I'll be the next one going that way. and was a helicopter pilot as well as military intelligence officer. And over the 33 years was combined with 14 and a half years in active duty, went to reserves and guard, but also had the opportunity to work on my master's degree in information systems, computer technology. I wanted to get my master's in teacher leadership, and I was able to get into corporate America and take those transferable skills that those that have served know you can take and apply those to everything, to include teaching JROTC in high school. But last fall, we all saw the miserable example of what not to do, those who've been in the uniform. When you leave a part of an area, we did not want another Vietnam era withdrawal. Unfortunately, to me, that's what happened. When you take your combatants out and leave non-combatants, and the men and women who took care of our lives, fed us, did our laundry, kept the streets clean, and you leave them behind. Unfortunately, that was a critical moment in my life, especially when I saw commandos, some of which I had trained, and I carried a coin in my wallet. This is a commando coin that I got from them, the commandos, which were equivalent to our Green Berets, who told me they were glad that we came and taught them what they needed to do against the Taliban. But to see them get murdered on TV and then see those 13 young men and women who died, in my opinion, needlessly, that was the wake-up call. I prayed on it. I'm already retired three times over. I said, well, one more time to go to work. So 4 o'clock in the morning, back in October, I applied to Tallahassee, went out in 3 months and 3 weeks, got my petition signed, and was officially eligible to be on the ballot for Orange County. As we all know, 2 weeks ago, the county lines changed a little bit. I'm still a Windermerean, okay? But nonetheless, Orange County is Orange County. And I decided to rise above my circumstances, see what can I give back to my community. Things have gone south for us. Inflation has taken a grip on all of us, regardless of where you're from, how you started, what your social economic status has been is. But I wanted to believe that if we all started working together and get our country back on its moral compass, get back to God, because God has been taken out of everything, to include the school where I tried to teach, and they didn't like me to use the word God, but they wanted to talk about everything else. That's not right. And at that point in time, I said, what can I do to be the man to measure up to what the plan needs to be? So I chose to step up as a Christian, conservative, I'm a constitutionalist, and I believe God has given me common sense. And that's what I think is missing also in a lot of the people who have chosen to be politicians. I'm not going there to be a politician. I'm a citizen who loves this America. I salute that flag, and I love it, and I salute all of those who love that flag, to be willing to die for it if need be. And that's what I did. Bronze Star recipient in Afghanistan, and I have other decorations I could go on for hours with, but I'm not going to go there. But what I am saying, this is your country, this is my country. We need to stand up for what is right. So I looked at the needs of the community, and I talked to over 10,000 people to get those 3,000 petitions. And I was surprised, and I was really glad that what I thought was three of the top issues, the economy, education, and then energy independence, it's gone. We all are suffering from what we see as inflation right now. 2.5 years ago, we all had about $1.50 a gallon for your regular. Diesel was $2.50. I own a truck, and I own an electric car, and I have a car. But now, at $4.47, the highest it's ever been in the nation, the GDP dropping 1.4% just was announced this week. With the price of crude oil, which used to be $44 a barrel, now it's over $99 a barrel, which equates back to your gasoline. Something's wrong with this equation, as well as food prices. I was down in Pine Hills this weekend, we were door knocking, and 10% increase in food and food shortages when our supply chain is broken and cargo ships are sitting out there in the ocean, in the Pacific Ocean, trying to get through the Panama Canal and try to get to the Eastern Shore. Something's wrong with how we communicate, collaborate, and coordinate for the good of the people. And I believe that I can be the person to go to Congress and be someone who's going to be steadfast, own up to those constituents who are going to elect me to represent them and not my own purpose. It's not about the money. I will walk away from that job if someone tries to buy me under the table. I will go out in front of every news camera and call them out. My dad always says, always call a spade, and know the difference between if you're on a farm, what a spade is and what a hoe is, because you'll mess up the crop if you don't know what you're doing. So I don't want to mess up the crop. I want to bring the nation back as one. We all remember on our coins, it says, "E pluribus unum," out of meaning one. Where have we lost that? We got borders that are open. We all came to that front door, not through a window. Everyone who wants to be an American should do so. Those who are here, we need to take care of them and do the best we can. Our first responders, I love her. She used to come over to church and protect me over there. But they're first responders that need that support, financially as well as morally. And the military guys and gals. Veterans, I'm a 100% disabled vet, but I'm not letting that stop me. And yet they have to tell me in a letter I just received, go outside and get medical care because we don't have enough doctors. Found out that the current administration wants to send doctors down to the border. Yet they won't treat the veterans who earn the right to get their health care. And the elderly, children, born or unborn, we need to think about the whole enchilada, okay? You need to do the right things right. And it's not impossible. It's probabilities and possibilities. But many people are not willing to stand on the probability that if we all try to get along, using perhaps the 80-20 rule, which I believe in Ronald Reagan's philosophy, let's do the 80% that brings us all together and work on those 20% that we still have issues with. We can get through this. I want to stop the inflation. I want to make sure that everyone, students that go to school, don't have to be chastised or be forced to return to what was once, in my opinion, slavery. I'm a Frederick Douglass Republican. Frederick Douglass had the ear of Abraham Lincoln, was able to walk right into the White House, and was able to get thousands of blacks, or colors as they were called, and on my birth certificate, it says I'm colored, yet I see all the colors in this room. That should not be the issue of today. We let that be divisive in the classroom. Parents are not domestic terrorists. There's something wrong with how we're trying to paint this picture. I can't solve all the problems, but I'm willing to be in it to win. And with all the help of the citizens of Orange County, now we have two districts as a result of what happened a few weeks ago with the realignment. This is now District 11, but I'm still going after 10 because I'm in it to win it for 10. And I believe if we can win both 11 and 10, maybe you have patriots like me, soldiers and sailors, airmen and marines are stepping up to the plate. I heard this now, eight of us, eight Green Berets across the nation who want to make a difference. And my goal is not to be just one of them, but I'll be the Mr. T in Washington, D.C. as part of the A-team to take down the squad. So I just want to let you know I love America, and I want you to consider, just look at my platform, go to votecal2022.org. The reason we picked VoteCal is this. My first part of my name, Calvin, represents me. I'm a Christian, conservative, constitutionalist, and I have common sense. The A is for America, and I mean America first. We can help the rest of the world, as I've tried to do around the world in uniform and out. But we don't have to deprive those here who need it most. I'm glad to see there's not many homeless land on the streets of Windermere. But we go just a few miles away, there's problems. We know that homes have been robbed and stolen from right here in Windermere. Right down in Dr. Phillips, four doors down from where my wife and I live. During the day, they took everything from a couple. Everything. It's the sad state of affairs when people think they can just rob, steal, and cheat. We need moral confidence back in our nation. I want to be one of them that can do that for you. And the L means I'm loyal. I'm loyal to that flag, and I'm loyal to all these constituents that are here and the ones that are not here. I will salute that flag as much as I salute. I don't elbow, I don't knuckle bump, I salute. Or like the Indians, I go out, I have nothing in my hands. But we are so fearful of one another, sometimes we let the color of our skin, rather than the content of our character, be our foundation. Because we all were created in God's image. We need to do the right things right. So I ask you again to consider me, those who now live in 10 on the other side of Hopkins Island, tell them Cal is in it to win it. Go to votecal2022.org. And for my good friend, and I have to call him out, Dan Webster, I met him right on his back porch in 2004. And I love what he did, and I love what he may do going forward. If that's what his claim is on this new 11th district, then I pray that we give him the support. Collectively, it's one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. I salute you, thank you for the time.
Thank you, Colonel, for your service.
Best of luck.
All right. Orange County resident.
And I vote for you.
On a separate issue, we're having challenges servicing this municipality. The town is having service issues. We acknowledge it. This is something we're trying to get in front of, and this is an absolute industry-wide situation that we're in. I'm not here to give any excuses. I'm here again to acknowledge what's happening. It's unacceptable. I was here just over a year ago listening to the council telling me how wonderful our service is, and in a short amount of time, things have gone awry. In a nutshell, and again, these are not excuses, these are real issues that my industry and my company is going through. And it's essentially, as I heard beforehand, it's in relation to the pandemic and inflation. The pandemic has created an unbelievable supply chain bottleneck. Truck parts, trucks, what used to take 2 to 3 months to get, now 4 or 5, maybe even 6 months to get. Labor is, it's been a challenge for the last 4 years. Now it's accelerated by the pandemic. Everyone watches the evening news and understands that CDL truck drivers, as well as other skilled labor, is just getting tougher and tougher to get by. And this is also related to wages. Wages are skyrocketing, but they're not keeping up with inflation. But it's a challenge that we're having to deal with. Lastly, tonnages, residential tonnages. There's more people at home working from home that are generating solid waste at home versus at the office complex that they work at, wherever they may work. In some situations, municipalities, we're seeing in excess of 20% increase year over year in residential waste. So we're a bit in a perfect storm, if you will. We acknowledge this. This is something that we're addressing with staff on a weekly issue. We can communicate better. We're having our senior staff communicate with the town manager, Dorothy, and others in regards to what is going on that particular day. And if there aren't any hiccups, we're just being very forthright and letting them know what's happening and what we can do to improve. To address the young lady, were you the one I spoke with? Okay, I'm the one with the funny name. Gotcha. In regards to the landfill, I don't remember that one, but I think I can address that. I think that was Steve Painter who may have addressed that. Landfills are also experiencing the same thing that we are. I don't want to call any landfills out. I don't work for them, but they're dealing with labor issues. They're having difficulties in many situations keeping transfer drivers, which are basically Class A CDL drivers. The wage scale is outpacing almost everything in our industry. So what do? Do I just throw my hands up and say, sorry, it's not a problem? No, that's not acceptable. Please be patient with us. We're working through this every day. This is something that we don't take lightly.
So, we certainly understand the issues, I believe. What's the strategy moving forward?
Therein lies the question. Mayor, again, it's not communication. Number one, acknowledging what's going on, when it happens. Some days may not, some days may run fine. But 2 years ago, maybe even a year ago, we did not have the same collection crew that we have now. They went on for better, higher wages. We can pay attention to how we're hiring better. We have addressed that. We have an in-house recruiting staff. Instead of doing the traditional means of recruiting, we have an in-house recruiting staff that tries to get ahead of, in other words, we're hiring more than what we need. And I'm not saying we're hiring everyone who comes into the door, but we are fast-tracking a lot of applicants that would only take maybe a month or two to really consider. So labor, we're fast-tracking labor, communication. In regards to truck breakdowns, which we are experiencing, Mayor, that's a maintenance issue that, honestly, I need to get back with you on. I know that they're paying closer attention to truck maintenance, and if a truck is down and another one has to be pressed into service, and then again, that truck may be waiting on parts. And also the dealers that we send our trucks to for annual maintenance, they're having the same. It's a domino effect, it really is.
So in terms of
I'm sorry, I didn't quite catch the percentage again.
So, for the yard waste on our street.
For yard waste.
Oakdale and Ninth Street, the yard waste in particular.
Okay.
Mine has been missed, ordering almost every.
Yeah, I remember.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Yeah, it's probably, I acknowledge, whatever she says, I'll say it's happening. I'm not gonna dispute. I called her, she was out of town, and we didn't get her yard waste collected. Was it late on that evening or next?
Yes, and they did bring my cans up for me because I was out of town, so yes.
Yeah, well.
I understand.
So, at any rate, and again, I'm not trying to minimize anything here, but this is something that's serious, and I understand your frustration. And trust me, every hauler, we all talk with each other, but there's only so much we can say, but the entire industry is going through this challenge. Again, no excuses, Mayor. What I will do is get a detailed action plan for you, and I'll get it to Mr. Smith, and go forward from there.
Maybe some things like, you know, for example, so if we're a little understaffed or there's extra load in the route, leaves the same people at the end short every time, you know, maybe we can reverse some things. And you know, not saying that it'll go away overnight, but let's be creative in terms of how we try to distribute the pain if that's the situation. And I think from a staff perspective, you know, messages out, I know you guys are doing a good job on social media, but we talk a little bit more about the actual issues. But I would like action plan that we can look at in terms of the performance delivery moving forward, so we know exactly what to expect and what those benchmarks are, and we can make sure that we've been at a positive delta.
Absolutely.
Council, any further questions?
Yeah, Mayor, I do have to say on Platt's benefit, he is responsive. I've got him on speed dial and text him frequently because all my neighbors have me on speed dial. And he's very responsive. He has not passed the buck. He's always willing to talk about it, and you know, he does keep us informed of what's going on. And, you know, it is a common, very common issue. But people, you know, do get upset when their garbage gets missed. So I appreciate you being here tonight.
Thank you, sir.
So, Mayor, I'd just like to see an action plan sooner rather than later, because I'm not sure exactly what the contract says. I can't remember since a year ago, but obviously the town's paying for a service. When that service isn't being provided, obviously there needs to be a remedy to that. So, you know, I'd like to review the action plan and then, you know, get a timeline associated with that action plan as well to make sure that we're not accruing costs for services that aren't rendered. So,
sure. I would wholeheartedly agree with that. And please understand, we're not just leaving material behind. We didn't come back and collect it. Granted, it is outside the scope of the contract. I believe sometimes a meeting will be on a Saturday every now and again. Material's not being left. We're not just saying, oh, well, we'll get it next time. It's being collected later than sooner, but I hear you 100%.
Yeah, I think that it's, you know, from our perspective, to make sure that we protect everyone's interests, but also, you know, we do get it. We do understand. We will work with you to make sure that staff work with you to make sure that we can get where we need to go, you know, just to make sure that we're able to measure that out and see what we're doing.
Councilperson.
Here.
So, a few times we've reviewed in the past doing one day of pickup instead of the two for regular and fresh, and from the environmental standpoint, that was a good thing for the roads and all that stuff, you know. The reason it has never gone through is because the difference in the rate was only like $6 a year per resident. So it didn't make any sense for anybody to say, okay, I'll deal with only one day pickup. But you guys might want to start thinking about that.
That is something that our entire industry is talking about from 2X to 1X. The downside of that is as residential tonnages are increasing, that's going to put more pressure on to get 100% of every resident collected. It may even require an additional one-third of a truck or half a truck or route, if you will, and that may affect costs. But Because the house count has increased, obviously, over the last year, so the town has run with that through annexation.
We should ask, man, listen, I know stuff out there, and I get it. You know, we'll do whatever we can to support you as you go, but, you know, definitely we'd like to see that plan.
It's absolutely
interesting. Right. Probably going to be in some of those other areas as well. It's brutal out there right now. So.
Thank you for your understanding, and sooner, somehow, it gets better. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, sir.
Town Windermere, Arbor Day Proclamation. Whereas in 1872, J. Sterling Morton proposed to the Nebraska Board of Agriculture that a special day be set aside for the planting of trees. And whereas this holiday, called Arbor Day, was first observed at the planting of more than a million trees in Nebraska. And that, and whereas Arbor Day is now observed throughout the nation and the world. And whereas trees can reduce the erosion of our precious topsoil by wind and water, cut heat and cooling costs, moderate the temperature, air, produce oxygen, and provide habitat for wildlife. And whereas trees in our town increase property values, enhance the economic vitality of business areas, and beautify our community. And whereas trees, wherever they are planted, are a source of joy and spiritual reward. And whereas the town of Windermere proudly celebrates over 26 years as a tree city USA. Now therefore, I, Jim O'Brien, mayor of the town of Windermere, do hereby proclaim Friday, April 29th, 2022, as Arbor Day in the town of Windermere, and I urge all citizens to celebrate Arbor Day and to support efforts to protect our trees and the woods. Further, I urge all citizens to plant trees to gladden the heart and promote the well-being for future generations. Date of this 10th day of May, 2022. Next up, we have the Town of Windermere Municipal Clerks meeting, which is May 1st through 7th, 2022. Whereas the office of the Municipal Clerk, a time-honored and vital part of local government, exists throughout the world, and whereas the office of the Municipal Clerk is the oldest among public servants, and whereas the office of the Municipal Clerk provides the professional link between the citizens, the local governing bodies, and the agencies of government at other levels. And whereas municipal clerks have pledged to be ever mindful of their neutrality, and impartiality, rendering equal service to all. Whereas the municipal clerk serves as the information center on functions of local government and community. Whereas municipal clerks continually strive to improve the administration of the affairs of the office of the municipal clerk through participation in education programs, seminars, workshops, and the annual meetings of the state, provincial, county, international professional organizations. Whereas it is the most appropriate that we recognize the accomplishments of the Office of the Municipal Clerk. Now therefore, I, Jim O'Brien, Mayor of the Town of Windermere, Florida, recognize the week of May 1st through May 7th, 2022 as Municipal Clerks Week, and recognize that the Florida Association of the City of Clerks, the professional association for Florida Municipal Clerks, is celebrating its 50th anniversary. I further extend appreciation to our Municipal Clerk, Dorothy, all municipal clerks for the vital services they perform and their exemplary dedication to the communities they represent, dated this 10th day of May 2022. And certainly, we do want to appreciate and love our clerk work culture. Next up is old business and our consent item agendas. We have minutes from the town council meeting. April 12th, 2022. Council, you can
Please approve, please.
Motion to approve.
Motion to approve.
Second. Any comments or changes? Seeing none, we'll begin voting with Councilperson Martini.
Aye.
This is for item I. This is resolution number 2022-04. This is adopting revised town of Windermere personnel. A resolution of the town council of the town of Windermere, Florida, adopting revised town personnel policy and procedures, approving documentation regarding the Florida Drug Free Ordinance policy, providing an effective date. This is our first reading for this.
So what's the question?
So
I'm just saying.
It's a resolution, not an ordinance.
Okay.
So it'll be adopted by the vote of council tonight.
Okay, thank you, Robert. Appreciate that clarification. Council looking for a motion to approve resolution number 2022-04.
Motion to approve resolution 2022-04.
Second.
Motion to approve by Councilperson Davitt, second by Councilperson David. Council, any further discussions or conversations?
Mayor, may I have one thing on that, please?
Yes, please.
Sorry, I was going to try to speak up quicker. There are just a couple blanks in the policies for the local assistance groups that need to be filled in. So if you could just amend the motion to allow staff to fill in those blanks.
So I amend the motion to have staff fill in the blanks.
Basically, for ordinance number 2022-04.
Resolution.
Resolution. Resolution.
Yes. All right, we'll get there. That's all good. Thanks, I'm clear.
And you're friendly with that, Councilperson Davitt. Councilperson David, sorry. I gotta get some sleep.
Rose was the second.
Rose was the second.
Yes, I'm friendly with that. I just thought maybe Mike wasn't working.
Like, hello, I'm over here. Just Rose will be happy. All right. Any further comments, questions, or concerns to the amended motion? We'll begin voting with Councilperson Rose.
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. Next up is appointment for a historic preservation board appointment for Mr. Tom Stroop. HPV recommends approval.
Yeah, HPV would also recommend that their membership be increased from 7 to 9.
Do we have 9?
What's that?
Do we have 9 right now, or are we going to?
They have 8 right now with this group.
Sounds good.
I would like to make a motion that we accept Mr. application.
I'll second.
And increase to 9 members.
I'll second.
There we go. Now we got it right.
I thought we did that last one. Didn't they report?
I think it was the last one.
No, that was HPV had a meeting and then we didn't get the application until about 2 weeks ago.
I think there was another committee that wanted to go to 9.
Parks and Recreation, I believe, is wanting to go to 9. But we haven't received the additional applications yet.
Yeah, they just discussed it, but at their last meeting. But I thought it was
on
council person.
What is
HPV.
Yeah.
That's all. It's for the HPV. All right. Any further comments, concerns, council? Seeing none, we'll begin voting with Councilperson Martin.
Aye.
Aye.
And that motion and appointment carries unanimously. One, this is John Fitzgibbon, JPF Development Solutions Consulting and Retainer Proposal. This is for the Windermere Pavilion. Staff recommends approval. Council, looking for a motion to approve.
Motion to approve.
Motion to approve. Councilperson Martin.
Second.
Second, Councilperson David. Any further comments, concerns?
Just a question. He's going to be acting as the town's voters rep.
Yes.
Any additional comments, concerns, or questions, Council? Seeing none, begin voting with Councilperson Rose.
Aye.
Very much, Council. Item number 2 is JPF Development Solutions Consulting and Retainer Agreement, and this is for general services. Staff recommends approval.
Motion to approve.
Motion to approve. Councilperson Martin, and for a second.
Second.
Second, Councilperson Davitt. Any questions, concerns, or
The only issue is a Scrivener's error within the amendment too, which we can take care of, and that's just the date.
Just the date, right?
Okay. Yeah.
Sounds good. All right. If there's no concerns or questions, Council will begin voting with Councilperson Martin.
Aye.
Item number 3 is IPO number 123. This is for Kimberly Horn and Associates, Florida Division of Emergency Management Grant Support Services for Butler and Bessie Street. This is in the amount of $25,210. Randy, did you have a comment on this?
She was looking for a time frame from FDA.
Oh, time frame.
The date is asked for a timeline, I think.
Okay.
That was
Yeah, I was here with
Kim Lamar
and Associates.
I can't see close to anything. Did you want to give us a timeline to things?
Sure. So we finished the design and permitting and bid documents for Butler and Bessie at the end of February. So that was submitted by the deadline of the phase one design to FEMA of February 28th. They stated that it could be up to a 6-month review period. We've been as expeditious as possible trying to speed that up. So if they do take the full 6 months, you're looking at an end of August approval from FEMA. So with that, you know, the town would take 1 or 2 months to bid up the project based upon town council meeting dates and a 30-day advertisement. So my estimate would be that you're probably needing construction probably somewhere in the November timeframe, which is a good time based upon the dry season, but we are at the mercy of the FEMA approval process right now.
And do you have, the BCA is not done, is it?
The BCA, the first round of the BCA has been completed.
What was that number?
More than one, which is
it was, yeah. I don't remember the top of my head, but I think it was above 1.5.
Okay.
So somewhere between 1.5 and 2, because we were kind of going back and forth with the FEMA reviewer on the methodology, and we had a couple of conference calls, and they've been very helpful. So through a series of conference calls with the reviewer, we fine-tuned that DDF table, which is the damage table, and we were able to get those ratios a little bit higher. And we resubmitted those, and they are currently under review. Along with that, they've asked for a lot of things like exhibits and things like that. So this IPO is for that type of service, as well as administering the grant process, you know, through construction.
So and the reason I asked about the BCA ratio is because we've been able to utilize that if there's any cost escalations. So if you have a cost escalation based upon your original estimates, if you have a higher BCA, you have a better chance of getting it through. And FM's been really infused.
Correct, and escalation is a factor, of course, now. And so we submitted it in February, we got some comments back in March, and we have been updating those unit costs every opportunity that we can as far as, you know, tracking the construction costs. But right now it's in the hands of FEMA.
That's good. Yeah, don't sit support back next round. We should off the agenda a little quicker.
No, it's totally fine.
All right. And with this, the reason that you don't see Gore up here asking for the same type of considerations because he had monies within the original scope in order to cover that grant assistance. These are above and beyond what their design IPO was calling for, was dealing with FEM and going through that 6-month process of doing the BCAs and everything else. But yeah, it's very meticulous work, especially trying to figure out psychological damages and how much that would cost in order to get plus one. But yeah, it's been quite the process. What's that?
The process is psychological.
Well, that's what we were joking about was, you know, well, how do you quantify that? You know, is it on our side or is it on your side? But yeah, we have gone through utilizing OCPA and other sources to make sure that we're going to be above that number that they need. And they said that they would help massage the numbers as well to make sure that we're able to get that construction cost funded.
Council, looking for a motion to approve.
Motion to approve. Motion to approve, Councilperson Davenport.
Second,
Councilperson Davenport.
Council, any further questions, comments, or concerns? Seeing none, we can vote. Councilperson Bruce.
Aye.
Thank you, Council. IPO 123 for Kimberly Hunter Associates passes again. This is 112 West 8th Street property swap. Are you guys going to present that one?
Yes, Mayor. As we have in previous discussions with people that are living south of 7th Avenue, you notice, you know, previous to this, when we acquired the railroad right away, everything north of 6th Avenue, we were just going to purchase outright because it was a lot easier just to purchase those because it was, you know, contiguous and just that whole entire corridor, we wouldn't have to amend or change. When you get south of 7th Avenue, we do have some area where we can do some property swaps and negotiations with some of the property owners. And this has been very selective because not everybody has been amenable to the property swaps. what we've agreed to in the past was 20-foot contiguous lakefront property, which adds to the east of the properties that are identified on the west side of Old Germain. And in consideration for that 20 feet of contiguous lakefront property, the value of that would offset the transfer of the 40 feet of the railroad right-of-way. So everything that we've negotiated is south of 7th has been 20 for 40. So you are adding to your existing Main Street and adding that 40 feet. Now that 40 feet would be utilized for your multimodal path in the future, stormwater, landscaping, similar to the linear park concepts that you've seen at previous town council meetings and or workshops. But again, we've been very selective, like with Councilmember Rose's property is contiguous with the Ward property on 10th Avenue. At 1036 Main, we negotiated that one because it is contiguous with 11th Avenue. And this one is contiguous with 8th Avenue. The only additional consideration that they're asking for, in addition to that 20 feet, would be 5 feet to the north of their property, which would be along 8th Avenue, where the town currently has about 60 feet of right-of-way. Now, the applicant is asking that because previously they asked for a variance in order to get the width of their home expanded in order to make sure that kind of matched the look and the feel of the area, but that variance was denied. And I was actually having Brad here just in case there's any questions relative to that. Not saying that you have to agree to that, but that is something that the applicant, or not the applicant, but the property owner is asking, would be for the additional 5 feet. And I believe they're here tonight. Here tonight, not only say, you know, or the additional area for them to build their home as far as making it a longer, the width would be smaller too, along the property line. But their viewpoint too would be, as far as the 5 feet and the 20 feet, it would add the total amount of the area for the railroad right away, the 0.48 acres. So they're looking for a fair trade for the amount of acreage versus the 20 to 40 as far as the value-wise.
So the 5 feet on the north side, I thought we approved that variance, so I guess we did not.
No, they're not touching their pool, which they have constructed.
Well, we'll move our septic tank.
So the 5 foot would run vacant property or all the way down to the Forest Street?
It would go all the way down to Forest Street.
And I'm sorry, what was you said that it would make sense because of the amount of property?
I'm not saying it would make sense. I'm saying that that's what the position of the property owner is that they're point is that the amount of property would be more equal to the land area as opposed to land value.
That's the request.
So it's like trying to get closer to a 50-50.
Yes.
Gotcha. Like, you know, if you gave 25 to do all the rest of them and 35 you kept instead of 24.
Yeah. Well, this one is different again because you're still getting the 20 on the east, which doesn't change the 25s or the other ones, and it still gives you that 40 feet that you need to accomplish all the goals that you have within that corridor.
I see what you said. And just so everybody understands, I don't think you mentioned that also in that 40 feet, Dirt Main will be in there.
Yes.
You know, it's not just multimodal path and whatever else you're putting in there, or stormwater and everything, but also Dirt Main is sliding over.
Yes. Right. It slides to the east.
I guess it's going to be a little meandering now.
Yes, it will. but again, the dominoes continue to fall, and the closer we get to having that entire corridor completed, the better. And then we would have a better argument. Let's say there's maybe one holdout, and I hate to use the word eminent domain, but that could be an option in the future.
Yeah, I mean, part of the issue along there, just so again everybody understands, is there's a lot of septic tanks up there now. So, I don't know where they go, but they have to be 80 feet from water and everything, so anyways.
From wells and
things. Yeah.
That's so, be the normal health department.
Yeah, that's why they ended up there. Because then they have to have a pump to pump the stuff up there.
I see the applicants here. Did you want to come to the podium then? When you do, just give us your name. Obviously, we have your address too, but you can go ahead and give it to us for the record.
It's an applicant because I haven't really applied for anything. It's just a
just making
a discussion about that. That I'm interested in the possibility of doing a property swap.
Church Buckner, 112 West 8th Avenue. It's not just to make it an even swap. Currently, if you're familiar with the area, I currently maintain about 10 feet beyond my property line with grass and landscaping. So this would be 5 feet of that 10 feet, and essentially it allows me to build a 5 foot wider house.
Right.
So that instead of being 200 feet long and 50 feet wide, it could be 55 feet long and something more reasonable. And 20 feet on dirt main doesn't help me because
right.
I have just grass there. I mean, I have 100 feet there that I'm not even using.
Yeah, because that particular piece of property is long and narrow with my record.
Yeah, and I get penalized because it's two front yards.
Okay.
So instead of having the normal 15 foot setback on a side, since it's considered a front yard, I've got two front yard setbacks.
Okay.
It used to be, originally, it was part of the house that is on Main, and when the people sold it or whatever, at some point in time, since I've been here, they subdivided that, and her house, before you were there, I'm sure, picked up that property. You know what I mean? They bought it from the neighbor. That's why the wall there to the neighbor, it doesn't have a setback. You know, it's right there.
Yeah. 5 feet of the neighbor's house juts into my yard.
So it looks like, and that's going to run continuously down 8th Avenue?
Yes.
340 feet long
times
5 feet, that's like 1,700 square feet.
I think it's 100 off.
I think you're about 112 feet as far as the length.
That's going to be more than 112 feet.
Yeah. No, it's closer
to 300.
It's like,
I'm sorry,
it's like 100 yards.
340.
Yeah, it's 340.
I was looking at the wrong number.
Times 5. So.
It's
1,700 square feet, so not a lot.
Versus 1,600.
And the town owns 60 feet of right of way on along 8th Avenue.
Correct.
Any concerns from the residents across the street on this, or are they aware of it?
I don't think they're aware that it is mine, since I do maintain it, because I maintain at least 10 feet.
No, this was not, again, this is something that we wanted to take to council for to see if you would entertain that idea, you know, the 5 feet. But no, we have not reached out to the neighbors across the street. Relative to, again, the additional 5 feet being acquired along 8th Avenue.
But what staff's looking for tonight is the green light to move ahead to discuss that and notify everybody and have that conversation.
Yes, I mean, we go move forward with negotiations. We're just trying to figure out if there's any deal breakers in that, meaning that, you know, if council is not willing to move forward with the 5 feet, then it's just the 20 feet. But if you're entertaining that 5 feet, we can reach out to the people that are adjacent to this property, understanding what the intent of the resident is as far as the development of that site, which would probably match the intent of what the variance was originally. Then we can bring back an agreement to the town council, which we have to approve anyway.
There are two houses that are adjacent.
Grant Prince and?
No.
Yeah.
No, he's on Forest.
Oh, he's on Forest.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
There's the one with the waterfall.
Yeah.
And then there's the one in the corner.
The guy on the corner.
I'm assuming this won't impact our water master plan whatsoever.
If I rebuild,
anything like that?
No.
Okay.
If I rebuild, it's going to be current to everything. My septic will be moved. Everything will be moved.
I mean, Robert.
No, we have 60 feet, and as you've seen with Bessie Butler, we've done everything we can in less than that.
Right, most of the time we don't need to use the well anyways. All right, Council, we need a vote, Robert, to move forward on this, or just direction?
I would take direction from Council to move forward negotiations with the parameters set forth in the executive summary.
All right, I see Stephen Withers. Do you have a comment, sir?
Stephen Withers, 712 Main Street. What the problem is, we, some time ago, said that we had two continuous properties on a corner. We allowed them the option of having the front yard and the side yard along one of those streets. This property does not have a continuous neighbor in the backyard. So when they looked at it, they said, no, it doesn't work. But to me, the logic was that they should be allowed to have a front yard and a side yard, even though their continuous property is the lake. So that's another option you can provide this particular property, is to say, well, it's so similar to a continuous lot. Our language got very narrow, but it doesn't really need to apply to this property. I think that's an option to look at.
Thanks.
So wait a minute, Steve. If we did that, if that language were adjusted, would the house, would that meet the needs then of the existing house?
Well, it just gives them more.
Yeah, so they could do what they wanted to do. And
possibly. I certainly haven't looked at their plan in a year, but it's certainly something that gives them an option that would not be different from all we get to every other corner lot.
But now we would have to revisit.
We wouldn't be able to have an agreement that would violate our code,
right,
and not follow the proper procedures. So if you're looking at saying, well, literally the 5 feet is authorized, whatever they were trying to get in the first place, I don't think we can legislate that right now. You would have to, again, either expand it to 5 feet, giving them the 5 feet, or they would have to follow variance
right
through the same process over again.
So we be setting a precedent here? Because we probably have other streets that may be 60 feet wide like you have, and other people may want 5 feet.
There's a need. There would have to be a need for that piece of property. Again, this is an anomaly because it's the only real corner lot that is adjacent to a railroad right-of-way that we're looking to acquire from the railroad path.
So it's a town need.
Correct. Right. So,
my comment did not reflect the 5 feet or not. It's just that there is options on that property.
But the other way would require a variance. If we already went down that road, and again, I'd have to revisit it. And okay. So it's really up to council in terms of direction for staff. There's no objection to having this conversation with the owner and negotiating something out that can handle the town need, maybe turn into a win-win and have it come back to council for your final approval, as well as notify all those adjacent homeowners for their input as well. Any objection?
Yes, I think it's, I'd like to hear what the other owners say, but other than that, that's okay.
Absolutely. Is that clear?
Yes, sir. And then, again, we'll have to get back to you to vacate that right away and then come up with a final agreement between the parties.
Great. Okay. Sounds good. Item number two, Ballfield parking lot paved by Middlesex Paving, LLC. This is a value of $27,447.50. Council, we're looking at it's a board option, but I believe, as we discussed in our last meeting,
this is for the paving of the entire parking lot of that ball field.
But it's not just the ADA parking that we first discussed.
I thought it could just be, it's not just the disabled parking?
No, it's...
It would be really hard to maintain a a square like that in the middle of a dirt parking lot. The maintenance would be a nightmare. It is property that's owned by the town. Middlesex has agreed because they're going to be mobilized here to do this at the 2019 rates that they're already giving us for paving. So we're getting a good cost for that. And then we can put the adequate ADA parking spaces that were requested and brought to the town's attention. So to me, it would just be harder to maintain that square of, you have a lot of erosion happening around that. That would be kind of a maintenance nightmare.
You walk around with nice eyes,
yeah. I agree, Tony, because we had that same issue with the historic schoolhouse where we had a square and it just really troublesome.
We're also looking at dressing up that area too, since we do have responsibility for the retention pond that's next to the school. We're going to be looking at different ways of how to improve the look of that, which doesn't let it bog the entire time.
And then pool.
Doesn't have the adequate setback. It's the only retention pond that never retains water, but it continuously has little kickballs and basketballs in it.
Yeah.
Is it in the back of it? Where is the retention pond?
It's on the side. You can see it. It's probably in front of the town. You can see it on.
One of the things we have,
there's no water in it. It's usually just completely dry. It's the only retention pond that never sees water in, no matter how much rain we get. But it still is a mud bog. What's that?
You said the one in my front yard. Yeah, the bills will be there.
We'll be working with the soil maintenance and also environmentalists to see how we can dress it up with some vegetation and whatnot, also the fencing to make it look nice.
Yeah, because it's a chain link fence now. That's just not.
Yeah, we're trying to change that look.
Okay, yeah. We regret. I'll make a motion that we accept Middlesex's proposal.
Okay, motion from Councilperson Rose, a second from Councilperson Babbitt. Any further conversation or questions, Council? Seeing none, we'll begin voting with Councilperson Rose.
Aye.
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 Aye. Okay, here we go. So that moves that item along. Liaison reports. Remind everybody that the public hearing for the Boats and Water Safety Code ordinance adoption is May 24th. Now it's been rescheduled, so there are some tweaks and changes to it. I think this has been sent out to all of council, but if not, we can make sure that we do that.
No earlier than 2 p.m.
More likely 8.
Well, and we have our workshops that night for Oakdale and mid-year report, so. If council is willing to attend, we can reschedule that workshop, but it's at the discretion of council.
I think it's pretty important. I think the more horsepower we have there, because this thing's taken a bit of a zag on some of the arguments that are out there, but I mean, I think at the end of the day, as far as for our residents, having this work. Council, any objections to rescheduling those workshops?
We would make it as close to the 24th as possible because we did tell those that were on the first two calls that we were intending on taking a final action in June to keep the ball rolling so they're not waiting until September, October before they see something that's enacted.
Right. We could, maybe we can bump it to the next Monday or something, or we'll have to see what works.
Just not the next day, it's my anniversary and my wife will kill me.
Everybody will be tired after that one. All right, sounds good. So we'll wait to hear from staff on that, but we'll go ahead and request that those items be rescheduled so we can have attendance at the county commission meeting.
Any further liaison reports?
Yeah, tree board is not expanding to 9, reduced to 3. I'm teasing. Tree board had a special meeting last week to discuss the 500 block project and the trees involved there. We are meeting our regularly scheduled tree board meeting next week with representatives from the developer to discuss the number of trees that we are hoping that will stay. So we are at very extreme ends of the spectrum on what they're proposing versus what we're requesting that they keep. There's some old heritage trees there that we would like them to work around, so see what kind of flexibility they have.
Good luck on that. You get the heavy lift, but I think it's important.
Well, it is. The plans that we've got show 96% of the trees gone.
Yes.
The initial plans.
Yeah.
So,
it's been a pleasure.
They were staying 4.
Yeah, 3.5.
Commission discussions have several more saved.
Yes.
But
yes.
The commission brought the package to us.
Yeah. Well, I mean, they've got a lot of the trees that they show are not even there. So they're on town right away. So, and touch those because they don't belong to you. You know, there's some give and take, I'm sure. So, the main thing is we want to keep as much of the canopy as possible. I mean, I can't imagine driving into town and seeing that just the parking lot and nothing left. It's just going to destroy the character of our town center. And they don't want to do that, I'm sure. And we certainly don't want to do that, so see what happens.
Excellent. Anything further down on this end?
Project meeting report is in the agenda. I was on the
Yes, sir. We had parts of tonight's meeting. We had some workshops, public workshops with the residents of Oakdale. And that's going to be taken to long range planning in a virtual workshop on May 19th. Tomorrow night, we have my town manager Q&A at 7 p.m. We have DRB, as we mentioned earlier, on the 17th. That's going to be for one pool variance. On the 21st, we have Armed Services Day. That's a new event that we're implementing in town. It was spearheaded by Pam Martini, and we're working with Diane, myself, and some others. I'm trying to work out the logistics of having it. Typically, again, you have Memorial Day, which honors the service and sacrifices of some of the military that's been killed in the line, killed in various wars and of their service. And then, but Armed Services Day pretty much acknowledges most of the people, all the people that are currently serving, and they want to make sure that that wasn't forgotten, and it's on Saturday, so it'll be from 10 to 12. And we're trying to work out some Zoom calls with some of the those that are in active military, so we're able to talk to the families, so we'll have some light hors d'oeuvres from J.C. Cream and drinks from Tim's Wine. So that's going to be on the 21st from 10 to 12 p.m. On the 23rd, I have to attend an Eagle Scout award ceremony for the Mathesons. I believe there's 4 family members that are receiving their Eagle Scout award.
In one family? Wow.
One family. So we're getting a plaque made and we're presenting that to them on the 23rd. On the 24th, as you just made the decision, we're going to go ahead and move that and bump it out a little bit. I do thank you too because my eyes have been dried out from looking at all the financials from the last first 6 months and trying to figure out how to make things work for the next fiscal year. The things are looking good, and we're going to be able to get a lot of projects done next fiscal year as well. So we're going to be moving a lot of dirt. Butler, Bessie, West 2nd Avenue, the Pavilion, looking at Town Hall, on refurbishing Town Hall, and then having phase one of the pedestrian trail and bridge constructed is just going to be a huge difference in the entire area. So it's going to make it look really nice.
Excellent.
And yeah, we did submit our ARPA fund updates by April 30th, which was not the most fun task in the world, but we were able to get it done. We did submit for $217,000 in recoverables. Again, that's part of that $1.4 million that was provided to the town for the American Recovery Act dollars. It's not like you can keep it in your piggy bank. You have to spend it for 3 years and approve what you spent on qualified underneath the ARPA guidelines. So the balance of those will be towards more than likely potable water projects. And again, as how I already stated, we're working on the HMG, or still waiting on the HMGP grants for FDM approval. So once we get that approval, we'll let you know.
That's
bricks.
Yes, so I am happy to report the brick roadway here at 6th at the roundabout, and then also at 4th in front of the church, has been repaired. That's something that many, many folks asked me about when I got here. So I'm happy to report we've been able to at least put repair in there. So I've had a lot of compliments from people about that. Secondly, the town manager mentioned that retention pond over by the school. There's also the retention pond at 1st in Oakdale, which is not in good condition, so we're looking at both of those retention ponds to get them functioning correctly, get the water quality better in there, and the better treatment facility for some runoff. So we'll be bringing that to you. The other thing that I'm working on is a draft for the assessment of town hall for this building, so that as the town manager mentioned, this will be updated and, as I call, rehabilitated, always with the historical perspective in mind. So working on that. One of the other things that is going to be coming your way that Councilman Davitt asked about, the last thing, is whether or not Middlesex would be able to do nighttime paving and whether there'd be a cost for that. They've agreed not to charge us anything extra to come and do the night work. So I would like to thank the police department because having them here is the reason we can get away with that. So thank you very much, DC. Appreciate it. The other thing we're going to be doing also is the sidewalks. I do want to mention that the milling and resurfacing of Lake Butler will be the first project we will get underway. We're going to do that in the beginning of June, so that will not require night work. And then we're hoping, working with PD, that we'll be getting to the rest of the, remember it was in 10 areas, so the rest of the 9 will be done on night work, just the end of June. So lots of work happening and things happening, so I'm pretty proud of that. So thanks.
Thank you so much. Councilor Ramos.
Thank you, Mayor. As the governor continues to sign the bills, Brad and I will be looking at what needs to be updated in the code. If anything, and we'll definitely start first with that new the new laws about the tree pruning, which helped the town a little bit there.
Thank you.
Can I ask how did it help the town?
There's some documentation now that folks will have to provide versus just having saying, oh, well, we've had an arborist look at it.
Grabbing something to say.
Grab it up very excitedly. So
I think that's excited. This is a huge, huge improvement to what was there before. So what we had to deal with until this law has now changed is basically just an arborist, a landscape architect, should just give this town a letter. It has one sentence that says this tree is a danger to the person's property. That's all they have to do to meet the statutory exemption. They can't do that anymore. Now they have to actually do a real analysis consistent with the ISA, the arborist associated with it, they call it. And they have to actually go through that official analysis. They have to sign it, they have to certify it, did that analysis and have that report. So it's much more in depth in terms of that documentation as opposed to what we're experiencing in the Tanya and I a lot. They would just give us a one-sentence letter. That was all. So now they can't do that. Now it does require an actual assessment of the trees.
See, it's the old developer trick, right? So they take away your tree ordinance, and then so you can't have anything for your, then you give you a little bit back for all that.
Right,
and
I
now we're we'll probably lose our town charter because I said that, but.
So it does give us a much better ability to be sure that it's done properly, because we all know we have done properly, like some of the lettings have been approved.
Okay. Just wanted to let everybody know that May 12th through the 16th, we're sending two officers to Washington, D.C. to represent the town of Windermere for the National Peace Memorial. It's our promise we made to the German family after his death. On May 19th, the chief and our honor guard will attend the Seminole County Police Memorial because, as you remember, or you may know, that Officer German attended the police academy there. He was also a member, a graduate of Seminole College. So they've been doing that each year for us as well. We have an upcoming vacancy. Officer King is going over to the sheriff's office. So we are going to put out some posting for police officer and reserve officer. We have Lieutenant DeStefano, he retired altogether from law enforcement, and Officer Sipic will be retiring as well in June. So we have some more good things there. We have Detective Allen will be receiving the First Responder of the Year Award by the committee. That's on May, actually that's on May 17th. And the chief and Al will be attending that. And just to give everybody a heads up, we'll post on social media, but it is National Blanket or Ticket time of the year. This tends to be an exciting time for the police department and the calls into the police department as well. So it's best that we post on social media, posted around town that they'll be out participating in this national campaign. As the Public Works Director mentioned, we have a lot of upcoming road work, so we'll have officers out there at night as well to make sure that the road workers are safe. Okay, I think that's it.
Did you have a question?
Back to the roads, Tanya. The giant divot that's on 6th by the Grove, is that part of the Middlesex? It's where they hit the water pipe and they came back and fixed it. It seems to be sinking again.
I'll take a look at it.
Okay.
That should be a warranty under their funds.
Yes. And did you go to it?
6th and
Oakdale? No.
It's the patch. It's the
6th, the big patch by 6th and the end of Ridgewood. Right. On 6th. Out in front of that grove.
It's
surprising if you don't see it. It's like this
big. Oh, yeah.
It's a watering, that big right kind.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying. Yes, I'm sorry. Orange County Utilities has finally got their contractor ready to go. That's some of the work she's talking about.
Okay.
They're overseeing, they're going to do that final repair. I think of it as Highland and that. And so
yes.
Yes.
Yeah, across the street from Highland. Yes, thank you.
Yes, they are doing it finally.
Thank you for maintaining, you'll stay on top of that. Every time a dumpster truck goes by there, an empty dumpster, it sounds like a bomb's going really loud.
Mayor, I would be remiss to say, if I didn't say it, with the passage of the personal rules regulations, it does help us with our accreditation process and application, and that was a year in the process of working on that. So I do want to thank DC Officers Warnock and Doug LaFleur, Heather Ramos, and Nora and Tara all working together trying to get the thing put together. So it took a lot, but finally got it approved.
I'm really proud of you guys. Good job. You know, it's a really big piece of what we've been moving forward with. You know, it's all about, you know, people and professionals and the best people possible for our community.
And we have sergeant applications coming up.
Friday is the deadline for anyone to submit, and we have two so far.
Okay.
Officer Shorehog and Officer Miller.
Good.
That'd be fantastic.
You can apply.
I'm sorry?
That's for the testing?
No, that's for the deadline to submit your request to go through the testing process.
So do we have two spots available or just one?
There will be one spot.
One spot.
Yes. And we have an outside source because of the nature of that type of position
right.
House. So we'll use Joyce Dolly again.
Impartial.
Correct. And outside graders as well.
I figure. Good luck to the candidates.
I integrate. Love it.
They should wrestle.
Okay. Or duel or something, right? I don't know. All right. Dorothy, from your end, thank you so much. And appreciate everything. Brad, anything else? You want to drop anything over there?
No. Okay.
I'll have to confirm that because I had it on the 19th. If it's the 26th, then...
I have it on both, too. And
19th is true.
I think it's... Yeah.
Yeah, because I didn't get my calendar right because I was working out with the family this morning and Diane texted me that it was May 19th. So.
Yeah, that's what I have is the 19th, but it was supposed to be the 26th.
Yeah, I think we can try to work that out because, again, the 24th was the date that I got the town council workshop since that's free. So I think they were choosing between two, which would have been May 26th or May 19th, but we'll confirm that and post it as well. So there's no confusion that whatever date is chosen is the date that it's going to be discussed with LRB. Sounds good.
Thank you guys for watching online. There's a lot of dates, so yeah. Appreciate that, everybody. And if there's nothing else for the good of the order, we'll adjourn at 8:30 p.m.